Hello, Muffins. Today is going to be the opening sequence of Trainspotting, and I'm going to do this in several sort of sections because there's lots of different elements to this scene that need to be discussed. So I really love opening sequences, I think, because the director is doing so much world building, constructing the verisimilitude, and it really allows students to as well to show off their understanding of like narrative terminology. So an opening sequence, we want all the terminology that begins with E. We want, I'm gonna have to remember it now, enigma codes, equilibrium, exposition. Enigma codes, equilibrium, exposition. And there's two more that have gone out of my brain, but I'm sure I'll find them as we go along. So the opening of Trainspotting, I'm going to do a little bit of talking before I start to play, because with this scene, it starts really abruptly, really, really quickly. And so what Danny Boyle has said in the interviews that we watched that he was trying to achieve in the film, and especially in this scene, is to give the audience a shared sense of kind of like euphoria. The quote that we use from him is he wants the audience to feel the rush. So that's what this like really intense opening few moments is trying to achieve for the audience. It's supposed to be really immersive. You're supposed to get thrown straight into the action. Okay, so with that in mind, let's begin. Oh, here's the wheel. I thought I'd queued it all up. Okay, here we go. Okay, so in my class, we always spend lots of time talking about the opening shot. It's really, really interesting because I don't know if you picked it up there, if the volume's good enough, you can hear the pitter-patter of his footsteps before he even approaches the camera. So that anticipation, we're already aware that there's action happening, that there's a chase scene imminent, and this is an extraordinary shot. So if you just think that the camera person's on the ground and then Ewan McGregor would have jumped over the camera, and do you see what cinematography, the foot lands, pow, right in the middle there, really, really symmetrical. Now, in terms of meaning and what this connotes for us for a film study students would be several layers of thinking. So we're looking at this with an ideological critical approach. We're using a social political approach in my group. And we're looking at this as the character of Renton in this scene is being established. There's an E word, established as this anti-authoritarian, countercultural icon. So what he's doing when he's jumping over the camera, and if you just think about the camera sort of like lying there really passively, and then the active motion of this actor kind of like jumping over you, if you could imagine that he's jumping over your beliefs, he's jumping over your traditional values, he's dismissing you, he's jumping over you, he's running away from you. That's kind of what I think this particular piece of cinematography symbolizes. We have this rather sort of like grey scene in Edinburgh, and this was shot on location. If you really, really look at the people, you will see a few people sort of like noticing the camera. That's kind of like a new wave kind of like aesthetic here with this. The colour palette is very muted. More on that in a moment when we get to meet Renton properly. But this is an example of how Danny Boyle is getting the audience to feel the rush. And it's a combination of cinematography and music. Okay, So got Spud and Rent running down the high street. That's a quite a good place to pause. Can you see the crowds in the background, just sort of like aware of the camera watching? Now, in terms of the narrative, we can be like, okay, they're watching the chase, but this was on location, so they are, they're watching the actual scene being filmed. So in terms of meaning here, we've got Rent and Spud dropping all these items as they run along. So metaphorically, we can talk about them kind of like either trying to cling on to this consumerist lifestyle that we are indoctrinated into living, or they could be rejecting it because they're dropping all these items, they're throwing them away. So the items are CDs, videos, looks like they've just robbed a Woolworths, and they are being chased by symbols of authority. Okay, so already we've got lots and lots of meaning just in the opening couple of shots.
Choose life. Choose a job. Choose a career. Choose a family. Choose a fucking big television. Choose.
Okay, so with Renton's voiceover here, it reminds me very much of a couple of films from the 60s, actually. One film that famously starts with a chase is the Beatles film called A Hard Day's Night, where the Beatles are so famous they're being chased by fans, and they're running to escape, and the music is really like pumping in that scene as well. It's very a feel the rush scene as well from the 60s. And another film that this voiceover reminds me of, because it's so direct, it reminds me a little bit of a film called Alfie starring Michael Caine from the 1960s. And the purpose of the voiceover in that film, and I think it's partially in this film as well, is to create, if you think about spectatorship theory, it's to create this alignment, this friendship, this bond between the audience and the character. So we know the character is bad, we see them doing bad things, they're running away from the police. But what we have here is this immediate connection. The voice is talking to us, and it's creating sort of like a bond of friendship. It's creating an alignment here, and because we've got this internal diegesis that we are privy to as the audience, there is quite an intimate connection that's made quite early. Now, I'm not going to go into too much detail on the actual connotations and breakdown of the monologue because that is a whole lesson in itself, but we've got this like extremely energetic sort of like opening, and then we have the kind of like the juxtaposition here, the things that he's saying in the speech. Yeah, choose life, and he's as he's running along. So it is this kind of like this message of youthful kind of like rebellion. It's happening here, so let's keep going.
Washing machines, cars, compact displays, and electric.
So again, he's listing here the trappings of a consumerist lifestyle that he is rejecting. He's saying everybody else living in this pseudo individualist bubble of false consciousness, he is awake, he is alive, he is anti-authority, anti-establishment.
Electrical tin openers.
Go Spud. Okay, there he is. There's the point. Oh, got it right on. So this moment in the film, in terms of the narrative, this moment is repeated about a third of the way into the film. So essentially, like the first third of the film is a flashback from this moment. So those of you that have seen the film, you know that this is the moment where he gets snatched up by the police, and then he goes into a program where he has to take methadone, and Spud goes to jail, and that happens a little bit of like a way into the film. I think it's about a third. So we've got this idea here immediately. We don't recognize it yet, but the narrative is very fragmented. Okay, it's non-linear, but it's non-linear to the extent that it's really fragmented, and the narrative structure of this film sort of mirrors his state of mind. So we've got this really fragmented sort of like part at the beginning, that replicates his state of mind as an addict. And we've got here a lovely, just to have a little look at this frame, a lovely fourth wall break, which is a Brechtian technique, which is all about waking the audience up from their state of false consciousness. So this concept of feel the rush is extended here as the director is trying to communicate with the audience really directly. And also the character of Renton here, the narrative voice of Renton, it's interesting for the audience because he's criticizing the mainstream lifestyle. So he's criticizing your commodity fetishism, he's criticizing your beliefs, but at the same time we have to have this alignment where we're gonna feel that intimacy and friendship. So this fourth wall break is really, really powerful at this moment. It's threatening, but also Renton is so charming and so charismatic that we kind of like, we want to be on his side, but at the same time, it's quite a sort of like, it's quite an antagonistic and threatening fourth wall break. So it's got sort of like a couple of different layers here to this moment. So the lighting there, it looks pretty natural, but we've got a kind of like a halo effect going on here. And I think it's really interesting that costume-wise, he's at the height of his addiction. He is in these sort of like these sickly brown colours, and he's really just blending in sort of like to the scenery here. Okay, so each of the male characters get their own little freeze frame introduction, and it's really interesting where Danny Boyle chooses to pause the freeze frame because they're doing something that appears to be quite stereotypically aligned with their character. Okay, let's keep going.
Choose good health, low cholesterol.
Okay, so as he continues to list all the trappings of capitalism and consumerism that are homogenous mass, we are, we have this obsession with, but at the same, we now have these juxtaposing images. So here we are looking at Renton here, and we've got basically, this is a really interesting shot, two Rentons on the screen. So we've got the man, and then we've got this shadow, this kind of shadow self sort of like element here, just to show that this is a character. He's implanting the seed in the audience's brain really early in the exposition that Renton has the potential to be duplicitous, two-faced. He has this, you know, we know that later on in the film he betrays his friends, and he has these two kind of like sides to his personality, and we kind of see that here. It's indicated here really, really early, this sort of like this shadow self projected onto the wall. And the places where characters are introduced to us is really, really interesting as well. So in this room, in this place, it's really decaying, it's broken, much like Renton himself.
And dental insurance. Choose fixed interest mortgage repayments. Choose a start.
Here we go. So you can see it better now. So this room, we can see that it's crumbling, it's decaying. That could be connotations of Renton, the decaying of his health and his mental state, but also it could be connotations and all about the society in which our characters are living in at the time in which the film was made and set. So we have this idea of society crumbling as well. What's really interesting here is the colours are amazing. We've kind of got these colours that once looked as if they would have been quite vibrant, but now they're sort of like decayed and degraded into these sort of sickly pastel colours within the frame. And even though there is natural light in the frame, can we see it's kind of got these bars and these cracks in the walls. So it's kind of got connotations as well of claustrophobia and entrapment in this scene.
Choose your friends.
Okay, here they are. So we have this group of people, the friends, and they are all dressed quite individualistically. I think I'm going to get this wrong. I'm really sorry. I think that Begbie and Renton are in Celtic colours, and the rest are kind of like in things that I always, it always strikes me, it kind of looks as if they've been they've dipped into the like the lost property sort of like thing at school and sort of like just had to put something on. So this is sort of like a still shot. It's made to look like a team photo that you get at the beginning of like a tournament or a match. And at the front you have the two characters that are clean, and at the back you have the three characters that are addicts at the moment in the narrative. And they're really introduced as sort of like individuals rather than a group as such compared to the other team. Let's have a little look. Here we go. So these guys are representative of the homogenous mass. Can you see how they all look the same? They all dress the same. And there's a kind of elevation here of status as well. They all obviously clearly have the money to buy like a kit. So it's all about like status, class, perhaps. And this idea that they are a team, they are a unit, whereas the other group is kind of like they look as a bit more chaotic, a bit more like individuals. This group of people actually are a team made up of, I can't remember the name of the team, they're a team made up of former addicts that were consultants on the film that helped them to sort of like capture that feel the rush element and capture some of the thematic elements, and they were given this this small role in the film.
Wear a matching luggage, choose a three-piece suite on hire purchase and arrange a fucking
here we go. So we have sick boy sort of like doing a dirty tackle and then sort of like not taking ownership of it. Look, that bit of mannerisms there is kind of like what it's not my fault. So we've kind of like got, performance wise, we've got each character kind of like doing something that is typically, you know, atypical of their persona. So it's a really good shorthand for Danny Boyle to introduce what is quite a big sort of like, you know, quite a big group of different characters all together.
Fabrics, choose DIY and wondering who the fuck you are on a Sunday morning. Choose sitting on that couch watching mind-numbing, spirit-crushing game shows, stuffing fucking junk food into your mouth.
Okay, so they're all doing things that are typically them. I really like that Begbie is really loving like going in there with a dirty tackle and tackling that bloke to the ground. Poor old Spud. You know his character just from that little instance. It tells you so much about his character. So they all get a freeze frame with their name. Female characters, here they are. They blend into the background. We have Baby Dawn in those sickly colours that we're starting to make links and connotations of addiction. And then we have the like the other female characters really blending into the background. That's the idea here. In terms of narrative, the narrative is restricted to Renton primarily. So if something's not important to Renton, then it doesn't really get explored very much in the narrative. So these female characters, this is quite a hyper-masculine narrative at the moment. So we don't have any interest in these women. They are just background, nothing really more than props in terms of how they're presented. I always think it's quite striking how Alison has got a really interesting arc, but her narrative is not explored. She just seems to disappear from the narrative and we don't know what happens to her after Dawn dies. So so it just demonstrates here that females in this narrative aren't considered to be significant.
Choose rotten away at the end of it all, pissing your ass in a miserable hole, nothing more than an embarrassment to the selfish.
So Tommy, there he is. So it's quite significant that Tommy is the moral heart and soul of this film. He is the warning to the audience, isn't he? He's sort of like, he's clean, he has a job, he has a girlfriend, he has everything going for him. But as soon as he starts to experiment with heroin. His life goes down the toilet to the point that he dies. And with this moment here, he's in the shadows, and he's clearly asking for help. No one is helping him.
Fucked up brats that you've spawned to replace yourselves. Choose your future. Choose life.
Lovely match cut there. And this is where I'm going to pause, and then there will be a part two coming up. Okay, muffins, I'll see you in part two.